All right, good morning, everybody. Welcome to ScopeX 2017 and to our first talk of the day. As you well know, that the Mars mission, or Mars One project, is designed to send some hapless souls to Mars and not return them. And I would like you to take a hard look at this man here who's decided that his life need not continue once he gets there. So I'd like to introduce you to Edwin le Grange, one of the contenders and also one of the winners of the grand opportunity on a suicide mission to Mars. Edwin got on board on the Mars One project in 2013 and has had sleepless nights since then, knowing what the prospects of his future are. But I must admit, the Mars One project is, to many people, a pie in the sky project. To many others, it's a very, very real project. And it's a very serious scientific endeavor. It also is a grand money spinner. So it has tremendous economic impact. And we see now that the Mars One project has even gone and registered itself on the stock exchange. It requires considerable funds to make it real and become a reality, but it is not a short-term project. We still have to wait for, obviously, the vehicles that will take our prospective astronauts to Mars. But I think that those in details can be explained better by Edwin himself. So Edwin, I'd like to hand over to you and enjoy.
Well, thank you very much, Jerome. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm very, very happy to see everybody here. Firstly, let me apologize. Last night, around 10 o'clock, my computer crashed. And my whole presentation with everything was gone. When I finally got to fix it, my PowerPoint was corrupted, everything. So this morning, I sat till about 3 o'clock this morning, and now till now, doing another presentation. So it's a bit short and a bit more hesitant than the other one. But hopefully you will still see everything that I'm talking about today. Now, firstly, today, my topic will be Mars and beyond, our place in the universe. And what is our place in the universe? Are we the most amazing, awesome beings there ever will be, there ever was? Are we just a small little planet in the cosmos that has absolutely nothing to do with the rest? Is there another race, another existence apart from us? Or was everything created just so we can understand how small we are? There is a lot of questions, there's a lot of theories. One of the many theories is that us and everything that we know is an experiment in an alien's garage. There is a lot of things that people can say, but unfortunately, I try to look at the facts that we know. So you'll see I'll be walking up and down a lot today because I need to get close for certain things. Well, firstly, who am I, and what is Mars One? Well, like Jerome wonderfully said, I'm Edwin le Grange. I'm at the moment 24 years old. I got part of the Mars One project in 2013, and I have been running around like crazy. For my life, especially, just so you get to know me a little bit better, in 2013 up until last year, I worked on game lodges and game farms. I was a professional hunter and game ranger. I also did weddings and a lot of other things. From last year up until now, I've been in the security industry. I work with Mercado Security Viewers. We do off-site high-tech monitoring of motion viewer cameras. We also have off-site fightback methods that we utilize to keep the guys from the sites, because it's a lot easier than sending somebody in a car to take 40 minutes to get there. Now, that is what I do at this moment. Sorry, he's a friend, so I'll a lot of times quiet him during the show. So it works a lot better. But through it all, I'm busy working on my own business as well, which is an aquaponics, high-tech urban farming business. And then through it all, I am crazy as hell with my friends. Because if you cannot live life to the fullest, why are you living it? Why are you here?
Now, what is Mars One? Mars One is a project created by Bas Lansdorp in 2011. He's an engineer from Holland. He sold half of his company's shares to his brother, and he used that money to create Mars One. Now, Mars One is a non-profit organization created to get humanity to Mars. It's a long-term project. Unfortunately, we cannot do it very, very quickly. But they said that if we look at the technology that we have today, we can get to Mars. So they looked at everything. They spoke to SpaceX. They spoke to Elon Musk. They spoke to Boeing. They spoke to everybody that you can think about. A lot of people laughed at them and told them, you are crazy. A lot of other companies said, you know what? From all the crazy proposals we've heard, this is actually one that can work. So let's start working on it. Let's see what we can do. And we will hopefully get to Mars before anybody else. Now, the reason why Mars One was created is because... that feedback. The reason why Mars One was created was for the simple fact that they wanted to get humanity as a whole to Mars. Not a country, not a specific guy, not a president. Humanity as a whole. Because if we do not do it as humanity, if we do not do it as the human race, and we cannot say that the biggest achievement in known history was done by everybody together, why are we doing it? If one country goes again, they are for the rest of history going to say, we are the country that's better than everybody else. Do we really want something? So that was why Mars One was created, to say that, listen, everybody can do it, no matter if you have a scientific degree, if you have astronomy degree, no matter who you are and what you are, you can do extraordinary things in your life. And that is where Mars One came in. So let's start from the very beginning. It's a very good place to start. 2013, Mars One started. They started with everything. They opened the selection program. The selection program then had over 200,000 entries into the selection. From that 200,000, they chose 1,075. Now, when you entered, you have to do a 1-minute video saying who you are, what are you, why are you the best candidate to go to Mars, what is your sense of humor, and then why do you think you can do it? Then you did psychological tests, you did math tests, you did English tests, you did logical tests, and then, of course, you had the big question that everybody always appears to ask. To answer is, what is your biggest fear? And after all of that, a very brilliant guy with the name of... I forgot his name. He's the guy who... I'll get his name now, I'll remember it now. Dr. Norbert Croft, there we go. Dr. Norbert Croft, he tested us. And he said, you know what? Through everything... These 1,075 are the guys that actually meet my criteria. Now, Dr. Norbert Croft has two doctorate degrees, one in astrophysics, one in psychology. He has done he has done training for NASA, ESA, Russia, India, Australia. He's also done training and selection for the British Special Forces as well as the American Special Forces. So he's a guy that knows what he does, and he has about 42 years of experience under his belt. So he climbed in, he told us what he needed. From that 1,075, he then said, okay, you know what, let's do medicals. We did full medicals, full EKGs, you had to jump, you had to cough, you had to bow down, you had to do everything. So there were doctors with gloves and lights and probes, and after everything was done, 702 of us were selected. From that 702, 695 signed our contracts. After that 695, we did a quick test. We got a booklet, and after about a month and a half study, he did a one-on-one interview with us, and on that one-on-one interview, he asked three questions out of that one booklet. If you did take too long on any of the questions, if you struggled with any of the questions, if anything happened that wasn't basically perfect, he told you, listen, you didn't make it. So from that 695, 100 were chosen. That 100 is where we are now. We are waiting for our next selection program. We do not know when it will happen, as they are keeping it on quite a short leash, and we're waiting for the trading on the Frankfurt Exchange to start. As soon as that trading starts, hopefully the money will come in and we can start with the next selection round, as well as busy building and sending our first probes to Mars to go and scout where we're going to live. Now let's quickly look at the history of exploration.
Why do we explore? Why are we such curious creatures? Now firstly, in 325 BC, Perseus made a voyage of discovery to the northwest of Europe. Now I'm quite sure that everybody can read that. Yes? No?
No problem.
Okay, I'll read some of it for you. Just the main points. In 138 BC to 125 BC, Zhang Quan opened up the Silk Road across Asia. That opened up industry. That opened up a whole new world for people right across Europe and Asia and North Africa. It was an amazing design, it was an amazing route, and because of that we could trade. We could make most of the stuff that we have today. Very lucky. Leif Erikson discovered North America in about 1003, a lot earlier than Christopher Columbus. Then we have Christopher Columbus sailed to the Americas. We had Vasco da Gama sailed to Europe, from Europe to India. We had quite a few others. And then finally here in 1642, we had Abel Tasman discovered Tasmania, New Zealand. We had the colonization of America. And of course, the one that everybody forgets to put on these lovely timelines, 1652, Jan van Riebeeck, South Africa. The reason why we all are all here. The reason why we can sit in here. A crazy Hollander decided, you know what? We needed to make a halfway stop. We are going to go. And he came to this amazingly beautiful, majestic country to come and just stay. They started to colonize it, and at the end of the day, we ended up a few hundred years later. Now it's because of this amazing discovery that we can understand that we are actually quite curious creatures. Now a lovely quote: not all those who wander are lost. I fully agree with them. If you look at our babies, our kids, us even, why do we look at the stars? Why do we look at the world around us? When we're about 1 year old, 2 years old, when we start crawling, when we start walking, why do you want to know what's inside that cupboard? Why do you want to know what's inside that drawer? What is mom doing? What is dad doing? Why are you doing this? Why is that tree green and not purple? Why is that animal walking on 4 legs and on 2 legs? We are curious creatures. That is who we are. That is who we are made to be. We were made to ask questions. We were made to discuss things. We were made to realize that, listen, there is something bigger out there than just us. And that is why we need to explore. So, what is next for us on this lonely journey? Of course, we have Mars. Mars One project, we've got SpaceX trying to get there, we've got India trying to get there, we've got NASA trying to get there. That is our next frontier. That is where we can rewrite history. Then we've got Project Starshot, made by Yuri, Mark Zuckerberg, and Stephen Hawking, announced in 2016. In July 2017, a test was done successfully. I'll talk about that a bit later. Alpha Centauri 4, Swiss Project Starshot. It's our closest solar system to us. And we have identified a few habitable planets there. So can we get there somewhere in our future? Then of course, Europa, the moon. Can we get there? Can we live there? It's got frozen ice, but of course we can eat it, we can live. And of course, asteroid mining. Now over the past few years, we have had lovely people saying that, private companies that say that we need to start mining asteroids. They've got crazy ideas like pulling an asteroid into Earth's orbit and then mining it there, and when it's finally mined, they can just leave it and it will fall to Earth and burn out in our atmosphere. Now, of course, for reasons, that was stopped. I do not need to explain why. We've got very lovely people, very weird people living on this earth. So why Mars and why beyond? Let's hope this audio is working.
The moon was man's first outpost, a first footstep in space. From the moon, we were able to look back at Earth and see ourselves from a different perspective, a sight that revealed a profound truth. The heavens are part of man's world. From this moment forward, the curve of evolution was bent. The perilous voyage into space was a challenge we were willing to accept and unwilling to postpone. The future of our species was now as much in space as it was on Earth. 44 years later, we're approaching the dawn of a new era. One that is characterized not by rovers and probes, visits or short stays, but by permanence. Mars. From now on, we won't just be visiting planets. We'll be staying. You will be staying in our pursuit to find life elsewhere in the universe. The search for life on Mars begins on Earth.
So again, why Mars? Why do we need to get there? Why is it our next giant leap for man? And what difference does this make in the whole big picture of exploration? Now, firstly, if you look at our solar system, and a lot of people ask me why not the moon, if you look at our solar system, Mars is the closest replica of Earth. If you look at the history of Mars, of what we can see, either through telescopes or by the little robots running around there and singing happy birthday to themselves, Mars is a lot like Earth. Now, of course, the diameter is a little bit smaller, so because of that, we've got less gravity on Mars. The average distance from the sun is 50 million to 229 million. The average temperature on Earth ranges from minus 88 degrees to 58 degrees, while on Mars it's minus 140 degrees to 30 degrees. The atmospheric composition is a little bit different. We cannot breathe the atmosphere on Mars. It will kill us, firstly. Secondly, it's very, very thin, so radiation is a big problem. Force of gravity, like I said, it's approximately a third, you weigh a third less on Mars than on Earth. So if you weigh around 100 kilograms on Earth, you will weigh about 33.3 kilograms on Mars, which means you're not fat, you're just on the wrong planet. The day length on Earth is 24 hours, on Mars it's 24 hours 40 minutes. So the bar ones will finally work at 25 hour day. The land mass is approximately the same, thanks to the fact that Mars do not have any oceans, rivers, or lakes. And in people on Earth, it's about 8.5 at the moment, where on Mars, zero. Hopefully we can change that within the next decade, if everything goes correctly and with plan.
So, is there life on Mars? The big question, the thing that can rewrite history books and facts as we know it.
Now, that is one of the main reasons why we can go to Mars, or we are going to Mars, is for the simple fact that when we looked at Mars, and you look at the composition, you look at the rocks, how it's formed, we know that that approximately 3 billion years ago, there was water, there was oceans on Mars. Now, it does not matter what theory you believe in. Are you a creationist? Are you an evolutionist? Or do you believe in the 6,000-year theory? It does not matter. What it does matter is that when we look at the rocks that's there, we know that there was water. We know that there was water on Mars about 3 times longer than it took for life as we know it to develop on Earth. So if water and oxygen was on Mars, was it possible that the same cornerstone that made Earth as we know it, that made life as we know it, was it possible that the slightest chance that that happened on Mars as well? If it did, what happened? What caused it to stop? If it did, can we find it? Can we find fossils, even if it's just bacteria? Because if we can find, then the possibility is there that we're not alone. If we cannot find it, then the possibility just gets so much bigger that in this massive, massive universe, we are the only ones. And if you think that we are one of a few billion stars in our Milky Way galaxy, and the Milky Way galaxy is one of a billion galaxies, more than a billion, billions and billions and billions of galaxies in the known universe, and we haven't seen the end of it yet. Isn't that just frightening to know, to think that we, few of us on this small pale blue dot, is the only ones in the universe?
So, let's talk about Project Starshot. Wonderful project made by Yuri Mark Zuckerberg, Yuri Milner,
and Stephen Hawking, was announced in 2016. It's a project to get microchip satellites to our closest cousin, Alpha Centauri, and it hopefully will be sent there if everything goes happily. We are still working on the technology that it needs to make it. How it will work is there will be a mothership that will blast into space. There, once there, it will open up. I know these kids have another place that they need to be at 10. I was warned beforehand, don't worry. I know it's not because of me, so... let's just wait for them to go out. Okay. So, Project Starshot. Once in space, it will release a few hundred thousand of these small little satellites. About the size of your phone, the smartphone at the moment, a little bit smaller, and it will work with solar sails, so it will catch the solar winds and ride upon it. Those solar sails will give it a speed of about approximately 50 to 20% of light speed, which means that the 4.6 light years that Alpha Centauri is away will take about 20 to 30 years to reach. Once it has reached there, it will take a few photos, it will get information, and it will send it back, and that information will reach us in approximately 4 years. Now, what will these very small satellites carry? They will carry a camera processor, a photon thruster, batteries, and the light cells, and that all will be deployed once in space. Now, if everything goes to plan, and everything works to plan, these small little satellites will also try and make a turn at Proxima Centauri, which is a habitable planet in the Goldilocks zone of Alpha Centauri. Which means that hopefully, if we can get there, we can see if Proxima Centauri has life, or is it just another dead planet. Now, in July 2017, I spoke about this earlier, scientists announced that precursors to the starship named Sprites was successfully launched and flown through a polar satellite launch vehicle by ISRO, which means that we are a very very, very, very big step closer to the Starship and Starshot project. If we have done it once successfully, hopefully, if everything goes correctly, we can do it again. And maybe by the time that my kids reach about my age, we can have information about another solar system. Now, who can tell me what that is?
Ion engine?
Yes, ion engine EM drive. Now, last year, NASA and the University of Massachusetts had a very confusing, if not horrible, leak in security. And they released that they have discovered, by everything that science has told us, completely against what we know as in science, in math, that they have created an EM drive. A team from China looked at what they have, they started working on it, and in this week, on Thursday, they announced officially, and they released a video with it, that they have created the first working EM drive. Now, what is so extraordinary about an EM drive? Our average travel time from here to Mars is about 8 months. We use it the normal way we have ever flown through space. The EM drive completely rethinks the program. It rethinks the problems. It creates something else. The EM drive can get from Earth to Mars in about 3 weeks. 21 to 25 days. If it works correctly, I have to add. Otherwise, we will be blown somewhere away, or we will be blown up completely. Now, the EM drive is wonderful, wonderful technology. If everything works, space as we know it will officially become a very closer destination. Will officially become a destination that we can actually go and explore. Now, Elon Musk, South African, grown up in Pretoria, boys high, doesn't talk to us very much these days, but a fantastic brain on this man, especially Tesla and SpaceX. And one of the many quotes that I love about him says, if something is important enough, you should try. Even if the probable outcome is failure. And then you think of Thomas Edison, who failed 1,000 times at making a light bulb, and 1,001 time he finally got it right, and the reporter asked him, so how do you feel about 1,000 times failing? And he said, I did not fail 1,000 times, I found 1,000 ways not to make a light bulb. If you combine those two, it actually gives you quite an interesting look out on life. Now, Elon Musk at the moment is busy with new technology. He's working on new technology to get 100 people at a time to Mars, as well as on cryogenics to get people from Earth further away. Now, there he's standing with one of his thrusters. It's one of the thrusters that has come down after it. He has officially made it so that he can reuse the thrusters on rockets. They can be sent up. And after they have deployed, they can come back to Earth, you can land them on a platform in the ocean and reuse them, making space flights about 100 times cheaper. So, if things are getting cheaper, there's new technology, who knows what we can do in the future. But Elon Musk is also working on a new type of spacecraft that will launch from Earth, refuel itself on Mars, and come back. We will also be able to use that to reach different, to reach Europa and different locations in the universe. That is the main plan he has. When the ship returns, he can just put it back onto one of his reusable thrusters and launch it again. Now, what makes this so amazing is the fact that it makes spaceflight around about 100 times cheaper. So, the Mars One project, which costs at this moment around about $6.8 billion to do for a one-way trip. If he can do that, instead of sending 4 people at a time, we can send 100 people at a time with a bigger payload. If he can do that, we can reach other destinations. We can go to the moon and create a colony, because then we can actually afford it. if he can do that, we can send people, 100 people, and create 2-3 generations of people. Then we can actually reach Alpha Centauri. So one small step, one very insignificant finding idea can have a revolutionary effect on the world that we have. Now, like I said before, unfortunately my computer crashed last night, so I had to do a very refined presentation. But at the end of everything, the main question in my presentation was, what is our place in the universe? Now, I always like to say that our place in the universe is like a 2-year-old's place in a household. He's there, everybody loves him, but he has no idea why he's there. He has no idea what he's doing. And that is us. We are floundering around. We are running open. We are trying to open cupboards. We're trying to see through the window. But at the end of the day, we only know a fraction of what's out there. We only know a fraction of what we as the human race is possible, is capable of. So should we stand back and say, you know what? Maybe we shouldn't do this because it's dangerous? Or should we follow all of the examples right through history and say, you know what? The human race is so much more capable of what we think we can do. The human body is so much more capable of what we think we can do. Isn't it our responsibility, our right, our privilege to walk out, expand our minds just a little bit, and say, you know what? Why don't we try and solve the greatest puzzle that we as the human race have? What is our place in this universe? Now, Jerome, how much time do we have left?
5 minutes.
Okay, we've got 5 minutes left. Unfortunately, we cannot do the Q&A. So let me quickly put my details on. If you have any questions, you're more than welcome to SMS, call, WhatsApp, or email me. I will then, of course, give you a lot more detail about the Mars One program and any other questions that you want. One question. Yes, sir.
The proportion of male and female successful candidates out of the 100?
50-50. 50-50. Yes, each group of four will have two male and two female.
Edwin, thank you for a great presentation, despite your problems. Why is the thinking not that it would be better to do a base on Mars and then from there go? Do a base on the Moon and then from there go on to Mars.
The biggest problem that there is with that thing, with that idea, is the problem that we have with finance. On the Moon, you have to take oxygen, you have to take water, you have to take food. So everything that we need to survive as humans, we need to send to the Moon first and then launch from there, which means we need to be able to put a refueling station on the Moon. Now, NASA's program, which is about $465 billion, is to create a space station so that we will shoot out from Earth's orbit into the space station, dock there, and then launch from the space station to Mars, land, stay there for three months and come back. Dock at the space station again and come back to Earth. But that is quite a considerable difference between 465 billion and 6.8 billion. So at the end of the day, the fact that we need to create everything that we need to live on the Moon, so we need to send resources every 2 weeks from Earth, is the biggest financial problem that we have. Where if we can go directly from here to Mars, we've got water on Mars, which means we can create oxygen and we have water to sustain ourselves. If we have water, we can use something like hydroponics or aeroponics to create our own food, which considerably lessens our financial problems. And of course, because it's everybody's against everybody at the moment, as seen on the news with everything that's going on at the moment, we will have to get the whole planet to say, okay, let's do this one project to get all the finances that we need. So, everybody?
One more there.
Yes, sir.
EM drive.
EM drive, it is a drive not that doesn't use fuel. Basically what it does, and that big gold chamber that you saw, you've got, in that gold chamber that you see, it will focus microwaves up and down, and then at the end of the day, as when the energy is energized enough, it will push it out. Afterwards, I'll quickly come to you and just get your number so I can send you a full explanation. But it uses less than a quarter of the fuel that we use at the moment. It's dry fuel that we use, and then if you use all of that, it also gives you a very higher thrust and higher energy output than normal thrusters.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
We've got time for another question if anybody has one.
Yes, sir.
Would it not make more sense to build the base on Mars, actually on one of the two satellites that go around it, and then transit down from the Moon down to Mars surface and back again, because they rotate something like 2-3 times a day in one case and about once a day in the other case?
Yes, sir, but unfortunately because of their shape and everything, how it's formed and how far it is from Mars, and again, we've got that same problem where we need them to send resources to it. It's cheaper. That's the biggest factor. It's cheaper just to go and land directly on Mars, because then we can decide where we want to be instead of guessing.
So you're just going to land on a glacier, drill into the glacier, get the water out, and you've got as much water as you want.
Basically. It's not a glacier, but it's a lot of terraform, and with the ground, there's a lot of frozen water. So that is, at the end of the day, what we want to do. But thank you very much, everybody. I hope you enjoyed it. Have a lovely day and enjoy ScopeX.